In this video, I'm going to be going over some Premiere Pro preference settings that you might want to adjust in Premiere Pro 2024. Let's dive in.
3, 2, 1.
So before we dive in, I just want to say I'm not going to go over every single little setting inside the Premiere Pro preferences, but for the most part, I'm going to be going over the ones that I believe are the most important when it comes to video editing inside Premiere Pro. There are also two new tabs that I did want to cover in this video, the Color tab and the Transcription tab, which came out within the last year or so. So let's dive in and see the Premiere Pro preference settings. So I'm inside Premiere Pro, and to bring up the preferences, we're going to go up to Premiere Pro Preferences, General. And we're going to start at the top and work our way down. For the most part, in general, I keep all the defaults the same. The only thing that you might want to consider is changing the options under Bins and Projects for how you double-click and hold down Command and Option for those keyboard shortcuts. You can choose the different settings if you wish, but otherwise, let's head over to Appearance. So for the Appearance tab, I recommend having it darker, so all the way to the left. And then for the highlight color, I recommend doing a little bit brighter. That way there's more contrast. This just helps me, but once again, it's up to personal preference if you want the lighter or darker screen and how dim or bright you want those highlight colors to be. So let's go into audio. Under audio, for the most part, you can leave a lot of these on default. The one thing I do recommend considering changing either on or off is play audio while scrubbing. Depending what you're doing in the timeline, you might want this on or off, depending if it's too obnoxious or if you do want to hear the scrubbing while you're scrubbing the audio. Next to audio interface, you can change the input to system default. I recommend doing this. That way you don't have to update this again manually. For example, if you go into your system settings and you change your audio output here, it will be reflected back inside Premiere Pro automatically. So I recommend just leaving the default input and output on system default. So next is autosave. You can check the box to enable autosave, and then you can have it automatically save every 5 or 10 minutes or so. And then you can update the maximum project versions. I recommend changing this number to a pretty high number. These project files don't take up that much room, so it's better safe than sorry. I'm gonna change it to 100. That way I have quite a few versions of this project. You also have some options down below where you can save to Creative Cloud and also enable to save the project as well. And then if you're working with team projects, you can choose where those files are saved as well. Then under collaboration, I would honestly skip this tab. I don't really work with teams, but if this relates to you, you can make setting adjustments here. Now the color tab is new. You have two options in here that you can check on or off. You have display color management and extended dynamic range monitoring. You can also access this in the new settings tab inside Lumetri Color. If you don't know, Premiere Pro 2024 has this new settings tab inside Lumetri Color that you can make some adjustments to your color management. So to get to that, I'm going to click OK and then change my workspace to color to bring up the Lumetri Color panel. Then next to edit, you can click the settings tab and you can twirl down under project and under preferences to get to those options as well. And just to show you, I'm going to go over to one of my screen recordings, and when I click display color management, you can see the difference in how it displays it. So those two options are there for you. If you want to see all the updates to Premiere Pro 2024, I did make a video going over them. I will link that video right up there if you do want to check out all the new features. But now going back up into system preferences, I'm going to go into control surface. For the most part, you can ignore this unless you have surfaces that you want to control. And then under graphics, same thing here, you can skip it. The next tab is the labels tab. This is really up to personal preference. You can choose custom colors here, you know, make it personalized to your own editing style. And then to the right hand side, you have label defaults. So you can change different label defaults for the video, audio, or stills, or even project panel items such as bins and sequences. Next, we have the media tab. There's quite a few things in here, so I recommend going through these. The first thing I would take a look at is the time code. You have two different options here. The first one is to use based on the media source, or you can have it start at 0. Depending on your project and who you're working with, and the camera people, the DP, the directors, and everyone, it really depends if you want to use the time code from the source recording or just have it start at 0. So every editor is different. Feel free to choose which one you want. The other setting I would take a look at is default media scaling. So to illustrate this, I'm gonna close out of settings, preference settings here, and go into my source project. I'm gonna click and drag this 4K clip into my 1920 by 1080 sequence. And you can see it's really scaled up and I have to manually go into effects controls and scale it down. What the setting inside preferences does is it basically automatically does it for us. So if we go back into our settings and change it to set to frame size, you'll notice that when we click and drag it from the source monitor to our timeline, it automatically scales it down for us. If we go into effects controls, you can see it does it laser accurate. You can see it adjusts it to 46.9. All right, so let's go back into our preferences. The last thing to change in this menu would be at the very bottom, there's growing files. I would just disable this. This might make Premiere Pro run a little quicker from what I've noticed. So I would just recommend changing and just checking that off, make sure it's disabled. And then the next tab is pretty important is your media cache. You can choose where to save your media cache files and your media cache database. I would recommend saving this database and the files to a very fast SSD external hard drive. So you can see I'm pulling up my SSD hard drive and I made a caches folder and I'll be saving it in there. No matter where you save it, just make sure it's somewhere that can be read quickly. Otherwise, if it's on a slower hard drive, it's gonna bog down your editing quite a bit as Premiere Pro is trying to read those files and it can't read it quickly. You also have options down below to manage your files so you can delete it based on a certain number of days or a certain amount of gigabyte level. So for example, I'm gonna change it up to 100. It'll delete once it gets to 100 gigabytes. The next tab is memory. This is another important tab to keep in mind. You wanna make sure the RAM reserved for other applications is quite low. You wanna preserve as much RAM as possible to Premiere Pro when you're editing. The next tab is playback. The one thing I would adjust in here is be sure to check off the pause media encoder queue during playback. What this will do is when you render something in Media Encoder and say if you go back inside Premiere Pro, maybe you work on a different project or you're in another sequence and you start editing, you'll notice that Media Encoder will automatically pause. This will stop that from happening. Next is sync settings. This is really up to personal preference. You have some options here for when you sync your settings. Next is timeline. This is the next important tab we'll take a look at. You have a lot of options up top where you can change the default transition time for video and audio files. So for example here, I'm gonna change my audio duration to 2 frames. What this will allow me to do is if I apply an automatic audio default transition to these clips, that just kind of adds a small transition to get rid of audio pops. So depending how you're editing, you might wanna change this. Same with default still duration. Say if you're working on a slideshow and you know each image has to be 8 seconds long, you might consider changing that to 8. That way when you click and drag images to your sequence, it's automatically, they're all 8 seconds long. Okay, there's a few more settings down below that I would adjust. I would uncheck at playback and return to beginning when restarting playback. Typically, I don't like going back to the beginning at the end, so I will uncheck that, as well as checking display out of sync indicators for unlinked clips. This is just helpful if things get unlinked and out of sync. And then lastly, I would uncheck play after rendering previews. Typically, if I render something out in the timeline, I might step away for a bit. I might use the restroom and come back and I notice it's already like halfway playing my video in the timeline. So I recommend just having that off. That way it doesn't automatically play when it finishes rendering in your timeline. So the next tab is trim. To be honest, I would ignore trim for now. Leave them all on default. And the last tab is transcription, which is a new tab. So you have the option to automatically transcribe clips in your timeline. And then there's two ways that you can go about it. You can choose to auto transcribe all imported clips, or you can choose to just transcribe clips in your sequence. If you work with a lot of B-roll clips, I would recommend only in your sequence. And then that way, once you drag the clips that you use in your sequence, it'll just do the ones that you really need. That way it's not working twice as hard trying to do everything that's imported. But each editor is different. Those are the two options that you have. And then down below, you can choose speaker labeling. And then underneath that, you can enable language auto detection. And you can also set up the default language as well. So that's pretty much it for preference settings. If you ever need to reset your preferences, there's the reset button at the bottom left of this window. Feel free to click that if you ever need to reset anything. But otherwise, you can click OK and you are ready to go starting to edit inside Premiere Pro. I hope this video was helpful for helping figure out some of the preference settings inside Premiere Pro 2024. If you want to learn more about video editing and if you're new to Premiere Pro, there's several tutorials on my channel. Feel free to check them out. I'll link one that you might like right up there. But otherwise, thank you so much for watching and we'll see you next time.